Hey guys, welcome back to L'Amour et la Musique and to my review of the February Beauty Heroes box featuring Blüh Alchemy. It's snowing outside right now, so I feel like the snow is creating some balance, light balance issues in at the filming, so bear with me as I am in this new space. I'm still playing around with the appropriate lighting, not looking overexposed. Boring stuff. Today's video might be kind of a long one because I feel like I have a lot to say, and this is one of those boxes that taps into some broader skincare philosophy things we could talk about. So what I want to do is tell you about the products in the box. I'll tell you my personal thoughts on these products as well as the brand, because I've tried everything in the brand over the course of, I guess, about the last year. I'll direct you to other places I've talked about it. And then the brand ambassadors this month, or late in January, had the opportunity to be on a group call with Becky, the formulator of Blüh Alchemy. So I got some additional insights from her about the launch of her new Botanic Retinol. Lots of nuance and texture, I think, to today's review and to these products, as well as talking about skincare philosophy, because I have been vocal about my trepidation, curiosity, being intrigued about this rise of retinol alternatives in the eco beauty space. So there's stuff to say on that. I'm gonna try and not make this an hour long. Let's try and keep it to like 20, 25 minutes and let's see how we do, okay? Go. Okay, so the hero product in this month's box is a new launch from Blüh Alchemy. It's their Botanic Retinol Cell Renewal Concentrate. This actually has four different forms of naturally occurring vitamin A. It's in the same packaging as the Multi-C Serum. Airtight pump dispenser. I guess this is like a co-hero. I wouldn't even necessarily consider this a sidekick. It's a full size of the eye oil serum, revitalizing lift rollerball. And I've always thought that this is one of the most beautiful eye products on the market. I've tried this in the past and I just think the packaging is exquisite and stunning. A 30 ml bottle of the Botanic Retinol, 30 mils, it retails for $140, and a 10 milliliter rollerball of the eye serum retails for $82. You can subscribe to Beauty Heroes either 1 month at a time. I believe the price is around $58 if you just want to pick up this box, or if you subscribe in a subscription fashion, the price of the box drops. So you can do 3 month, 6 month, and I think 12 months. Okay, lots of detail on this Botanic Retinol product. First of all, we do have to acknowledge that bakuchiol / phytoretinols in general are the new it thing in eco beauty. I feel like they're even starting to supplant CBD in skincare in eco beauty, which I feel was really the ingredient that I have heard about ad nauseum over the last couple of years. But now it's all about bakuchiol. Have I been saying bakuchiol? I say bakuchiol or bakuchiol kind of interchangeably, although I do think it is bakuchiol. To the best of my knowledge, this is traditionally used in Ayurveda, and I actually talked about this with Michelle Ranavat, who is featured in the January Beauty Heroes box, and we talked about it on an interview I did with her for Your Purpose is Beauty, which is going to be coming out on February 17th, that episode, and we talked a bit about bakuchiol, because she might even be coming out with a bakuchiol product, if I'm remembering correctly. Check the description box below if you want to go check out Your Purpose is Beauty, the podcast that launched at the end of December. And I have some other references to content I've done on the podcast related to Blüh Alchemy. So all the information on that is down below, will be down below. Skimming the little insert here. Botanic Retinol, this product is a transformative concentrate powered by bakuchiol, the plant-based alternative to retinol, clinically proven to dramatically improve skin texture, boost collagen production, and support firmness and elasticity without the negative side effects of the chemical derivative. So I do think that there are some compelling studies out there about the effect that bakuchiol can have on the appearance of your skin. In particular, someone directed me to Dr. Sam Bunting's video here on YouTube on bakuchiol, and I think she cites a 12-week before and after study. I'm not sure if that study compared the results to a traditional retinol or a no retinol. It's like, I hear these things like clinical studies or trials thrown around, and I just haven't personally had time to go and investigate how the studies are set up, what the control is, and also 12 weeks is still kind of a really short time frame to assess something like that. People are saying that bakuchiol has clinically significant results. I don't know why I'm talking about this now. This is really more for the skincare philosophy discussion. I really just wanted to talk about the formulation here. So the thing that I think, and I'm gonna go ahead and say that of the retinol alternative products or bakuchiol products that have come across my desk or, you know, skincare routine, testing in a skincare routine, it's the one that I'm going to direct people to if they're interested in this kind of product, because it's not just the bakuchiol that I feel sometimes can just get kind of thrown into formulas, but I do think the synergy of Becky's formulations is what makes her products more than just like some other retinol alternative kind of product. Bakuchiol is supported by 4 additional plant-derived sources of vitamin A. Fig, cacao, C-A-C-A-Y, carrot seed oil, and watermelon bioferment to increase bioavailability. While plant-derived vitamin A is not drying, the inclusion of ceramides, lupine amino acids, tamarind, seed cellular extract, Tasmanian kelp cellular extract, and resurrection plant ensures skin is drenched in moisture. So there's a lot going on, and normally these sorts of complex formulations are a little overwhelming to me. Think, for example, like Tata Harper formulations, which have super, super long ingredient lists. To me, even though this ingredient list is pretty stacked, I trust the formulation based on my previous experience with Blüh Alchemy products. A lot of the botanicals that she sources are actually Australian, and I think I've seen swirling around that can we not call it a beauty, like Australian beauty? Like, for example, Kakadu plum, I think, is an Australian botanical. The reason that they're so intriguing and tend to have such high antioxidant and skin loving and regenerating promise and potential and effect is that Australia's climate is very severe and there's a lot of intense fluctuations. So the plants become a storehouse for these antioxidants because they have to basically steel themselves against really dramatic climate fluctuations. The other really noteworthy thing about Blüh Alchemy that I learned from Becky is that her extraction techniques are very focused on preserving the integrity of the plants. Now, there are brands I've come across that I think are really, really attuned to the processing of their ingredients. So Infiore would of course be one. I think Laurel is really attuned to this, and plenty of others. You know, I just mentioned the ones that I have a lot of experience with. The extraction techniques that she uses for the cellular extracts don't destroy the plant biomatrix. I guess these sorts of extracts are, and these extraction techniques are very expensive to execute and to work with, which is why they are a more luxury price point. So the cellular extracts, I have it like written down in my very, very beat up bullet journal. The cellular extracts and the botanic retinol, which function as an antioxidant, are the Tasmanian kelp, the tamarind, and then 2 phytonutrients, flame tree and emu apple. So in addition to the Australian botanicals, she also sources some ingredients from the Amazon. So cacao nut oil is coming from the Amazon, which apparently has 3 times more vitamin A than rosehip seed oil. It's 68% linoleic acid, good for acne and keratin buildup. These are all my chicken scratch notes I took on this call. Really, really interesting information though. This could have just been with respect to the multi-C serum, but I actually asked Becky about the stability of the botanic retinol. So I think in both of these, the extracts have up to 2 years of stability in an aqueous formula, especially for a vitamin C product. That's really significant. And I think the same holds true here. Although Becky does recommend using, I think, both of these, but particularly the botanic retinol within 9 months of opening. So I've told you a bit about the ingredients. I'm not normally an ingredient buff or nerd. I'm more about the experience of a product. I've already been recording for so long. I feel like this video is gonna go way, way over. But just to talk about the product itself, it's like a light blue gel. It's really cooling. It's very, very lightweight. The predominant thing you're gonna smell with it is blue tansy, far and away. So I have talked about my ambivalence around blue tansy. It used to be an essential oil I loved when a chiropractor would use Young Living. Why do I always blank on the name of the oil blend? It wasn't the Thieves oil. There's Valor. I think it was Young Living Valor essential oil. That was my very first introduction to Blüh Tansy. And then it started cropping up in lots of eco beauty products. Blüh Tansy, I think just, it varies a lot. Some of them smell, I don't know, like a little bit flat, more flat than others. And I will say that of everything Blüh Tansy I think I have ever smelled, I actually quite like it here. It's very bright and sort of well integrated with, I forget what else is in here scent-wise, perhaps jasmine? Yeah, jasmine flower oil and Blüh Tansy are kind of the main scent ingredients, and ylang ylang. It works really well here. It could just also be the source of Blüh Tansy that she's getting. Texture is kind of very similar to any other serum. It's not super runny. It's very just a kind of straightforward gel. As far as where this would sit in a skincare routine, actually, why don't we quickly talk about the oil, and then I'll talk about my experience and where they sit in a skincare routine. So the eye oil serum, the noteworthy ingredients here are green coffee bean and hibiscus. I don't have a lot of notes on this one because we mostly talked about the botanic retinol. This is a very beloved product, I guess, in her line, and it also has a very prominent vanilla smell. She said she has people that tell her they use this like all over the face and not just around the eyes. This has raw green coffee bean oil as well as green tea seed oil. A lot of eye oil formulas will incorporate green coffee bean or coffee bean oil because of, I think, the caffeine, and it has like that tight, like sort of subtle tightening and firming effect. But I guess it's in a very high proportion in this formula, which makes it kind of that much more potent. The oil itself has like a slight cloudiness to it. Kind of interesting. It's full of so much good stuff. Blüh Alchemy does have a face oil in their range. It's called the antioxidant face oil. But like I'm saying, apparently some people like to just use this all over the face, which is how I have been testing these products. This also has Eye Bright in it, which is very prominently featured in the Infiore V Clair Supreme, which is the eye cream I have been exclusively using since the holidays. This also has Kakadu Plum. That's an ingredient that Becky seems to work with a lot in her formulas. Licorice, red raspberry seed oil, rosehip seed oil, and vanilla. Okay, I didn't really lead off with this, and I should have, but actually I talked about it extensively in my 2018-2019 Beauty Heroes retrospective, because I talked about the Blüh Alchemy box that was featured in 2019. It was the multi-C serum, which came with the toning elixir. Loved both of the products so much, and I really sang the praises of Blüh Alchemy as a special discovery and brand in that video. So if you want to hear more, that's there. But yes, overall, I find Blüh Alchemy to be like going into a garden in the height of summertime and just like macerating the plants and the herbs. The products feel so fresh. As far as skincare routine and how I have been using these products, so botanic retinol is something that I've only tried at night. I do think it is, in fact, Becky has said that it's safe to use during the day. A lot of the concerns with retinol, synthetic and to some extent, I guess, these phyto-retinol, retinol alternatives, is that they can sensitize your skin to sun exposure, so they're better used in the evening, whereas vitamin C products we're told to use in the morning because they actually protect your skin against the elements, although you can use vitamin C products overnight to help with collagen rebuilding and production is what I have heard. I take everything I hear about skincare from all kinds of different experts with large grains of salt, and basically just trial everything on myself. It within the line, the multi-C serum would be your morning serum, the botanic retinol would be your evening serum. We also have to think about layering, and my approach to layering, as with everything, is a little bit unconventional with respect to the party line in conventional and eco skincare. So typically you would cleanse, double cleanse, tone, serum, oil if you want to, or cream moisturizer or balm. In a case like this, I do follow a more traditional layering approach. Usually though, I will cleanse, put down an oil, like a low molecular weight oil, top with a toner, and then like a water-based serum I'll do on top of that. So I guess you could use that this way, but let's just, for simplicity's sake, and the way I've been testing it is in a more traditional layering situation. So I will cleanse and or double cleanse, depending on how much makeup I've been wearing during the day. For toning, I absolutely love the Blüh Alchemy toner, and I think it's 100% worth picking up to use with these products if you've never tried it. It's the main ingredient in there is something called finger lime caviar. What I will say about Blüh Alchemy is the products I feel really benefit from being used together. So if you're in need of a toning mist, huge plug for the Blüh Alchemy toning mist. I think it's amazing. But I've been alternating between the Josh Rosebrook Hydrating Accelerator and my Achia the Optimist. This was one of my favorite products of 2019, which was another video I just did. So I've typically been reaching for this, and I feel kind of like the scent profile of this is really, well, both of these are really nice with this routine. This is more vanilla, so it's actually very, very synchronous with the eye oil serum. So toner, then I'll go in with two pumps. I've been doing two pumps of the Botanic Retinol. I've only used this maybe 3 to 4 times in the couple weeks that I've been testing it. This is a product, also, I think that bakuchiol needs some time to store up in the skin and the other antioxidants in the formula. I have noticed kind of nice skin in the morning after using this, just as like a one-off or using it a couple times, but you get the best results when you use it consistently. And whatever consistently means for you, you could use it once a day, twice a day, or you could use it twice a week. In a skincare routine, I would probably use this every 2 to 3 nights because I am a little bit more sensitive skin type. My skin can get overtreated really easily, but that's not a concern for a lot of people. So particularly if you have acne or acne scarring or hyperpigmentation, or you're really concerned about fine lines, whether it's like surface dehydration fine lines or more deep setting, aging related lines, this would be something you may want to work up to using every night or just start using it every night. It is going to be way more gentle than a traditional retinol. Keep in mind, I've never used a traditional retinol with any, I've used them like once here or there. Similar to a traditional retinol, you would have to use this over time to let the ingredients build up, your body synthesize them in the way that's going to give the best results. I hope that makes sense. So 2 pumps of serum, it absorbs pretty quickly. The blue tansy is really, really prominent. So if you hate blue tansy and can't stand it, I would pass on this because it's very prominent, and it does, you will smell it back and it'll linger on the skin. But as someone that isn't the biggest blue tansy fan, I actually do like it here. I'll just take the eye roller ball and go super, super generous all over the orbital region. I focus between my eyebrows, and then I don't really like rolling it all over my face, but I'll roll it onto my fingers. You can get a fair amount of oil out that way, and I'll tap that over the rest of my face. Then if I need, it's very, very case by case or night by night. Sometimes I need more moisture than that. Sometimes I'm totally good with that. But my favorite, I should say, if I don't want to do the eye oil serum all over the face, another oil I've really been liking, not a Beauty Heroes product, this is actually a Boxwalla product, the Votary Super Seed Facial Oil I've been liking a lot for a routine like this, because I don't like to have too many things competing in a skincare routine. I like to pick one thing that's really kind of the star. I'm not sure it would be enough on its own for anybody as part of an evening skincare routine. I think you're either gonna wanna put some oil or at minimum a bit of a cream moisturizer down over top. This is nice because it's just a bunch of seed oils. It doesn't have, like, these are like opposite products, right? These are a bunch of naturally occurring antioxidant seed oils, but this has a bunch of intense antioxidant cellular extracts. So to me, these are actually a really nice pairing in lieu of something like another oil in Blüh Alchemy's range that's kind of automatically gonna be in sync with this product. Now, if I just want to do this and no oil, I have been loving Iuna Terra, and I'm really loath to talk about it because it's the most expensive skincare product I've ever come across, like ever. I think this retails for $450. It was generously sent to me as a gift. I like it better than cream one or cream two. If you have money to blow, money is no object for you, and you love Iuna, I say go for it. Or just keep your eyes peeled for ways that you can get like a travel size of this, because I think it's definitely worth a look. So I've been really liking this as part of my skincare routine. I never wash my face in the morning, but when I have used this, I do make an effort to splash my skin extra with water in the morning, just so, I know that that's more of an issue with traditional retinols. You actually do want to wash your face in the morning. I think, at least that's what I've heard, but I get the feeling that I want to start my morning with a clean slate after this. So then in the morning, I would just go in with toner, multi-C serum, a little bit of oil in the morning. I really like the Honua Olena oil over top of this eye product. This, I did get a question on this actually, if this is good for morning. It depends on so many things. It depends on how fast your skin drinks up oil. So the surface level moisture or dehydration that your skin is experiencing in any given moment, how quickly you need to put on makeup if you're going to wear makeup after, how long you have to let it sink in, depends on all of those things. I personally prefer using this in the evening. Oils, with the exception of Lilfox Kalahari, I tend to shy away from in the morning just based on my own oily eye area and often wearing makeup. But if you were judicious and you were to just maybe even roll out a tiny bit onto your finger and tap, I think it's fine. So you can totally adjust and just use more or less depending on your own context. Okay, before we close out talking about botanic retinols as part of this broader discussion, I wanna make sure that I'm not missing questions because I had done a quick query on Instagram. Okay, someone asked, curious to know how the eye oil compares to Stark Astral and Maya Chia Eye Achiever in terms of sinking through the skin. It's comparable, more comparable, I think, to Stark Astral. So, and they are a bit heavier. Maya Chia is a little bit lighter viscosity and more similar to something like Lilfox Kalahari. This is comparable to Stark Astral. So I think it takes a little bit more time to sink in, which is perfect for night, sometimes not as perfect in the morning, but again, it really depends on your own skin context. Someone said, nothing to add, just excited to hear your thoughts. Thank you. I wasn't wowed by the sea serum in the last box, which is totally fine. I really like this product a lot and didn't use the other product, so the toner, and curious to hear your thoughts on the line overall. I really like the brand. I totally accept that it's not gonna resonate with everybody, but like I'm saying, I think if you use multiple products from the line together and you get the cohesive experience and you use them over time, I do think they give really great results. So I would actually totally buy another bottle of the Multi-C Serum. I'm gonna try the Marie Veronique CE and Ferulic first, but this would be one I would totally go back to. And for a very specific reason, which is that nearly all vitamin C products I've ever tried dry my skin out within, you know, a week. Even if I've used them two or three times over the course of a week, I start getting dryness. And this one never did that to me. And so I think that Becky formulates specifically to counteract the potential drying effects of extracts or more intensely formulated products. Someone else asked, would you suggest using the botanic retinol in place of a serum after oil/toner? So I think this question is in the context of the oil toner serum layering step. So I think I kind of already addressed that, but yes, this would be in my routine anyway. This is like the star of the show. I wouldn't use another serum with it. You could experiment with using it after a low molecular weight oil. So basically, like, you just don't want to use a heavy, like, squalane type of oil as your, if you're going to do oil first. But if you're going to use like a light jojoba, argan, grapeseed oil, products are going to be able to penetrate through that depending on the oil. This is a good transition question into the end of this. Someone asked, can you talk about how you think the retinol would be for sensitive skin and just your thoughts on the retinol alternative in general? And then the last question that's a really good transition is, I'm 31 and don't want to use retinols because I don't think I need them at my age. Could you point out what skin types you think would benefit from this product? Okay, so as far as the sensitive skin question, there was someone on our call that asked about sensitivity, who, this was someone that expressed having sensitive skin reactions even to these bakuchiol or phyto-retinol alternative products in Eco Beauty. And Becky just said, like, always patch test first, which is, you know, if you know that your skin is sensitive, you would probably want to do that. You know, try a small amount and see how your skin fares and just kind of adjust, like, see how your skin does one night, then maybe take a night off and try the next night. So my inclination, based on my experience with the vitamin C and with the brand in general, is that if you are a sensitive skin type and you want to use a product like this, that this is a good one to try compared to other ones that I've seen. I like it better, actually, than the Graydon Full Moon Serum, and that one is more powerful, maybe not the right word, but I saw a more visible, immediate, like, smoothing effect. This is like the long burn or like longer term approach. I think the more you use it, the more results you're gonna see, but because of that, I think it's better for people that are sensitive and may have had a reaction to something like the Graydon Full Moon Serum. So I actually think it's a great product for people that want a retinol alternative product and are sensitive skin type. I think it's really good for all skin types if you want this kind of product. And like I said, it's the one that I'm going to draw people's attention to that ask me about this kind of product. To the person that said, I'm 31 and don't want to use a retinol right now because I don't think I need it, that's me. I'm 37 years old and I have never felt like I want to use a retinol or even necessarily a botanic retinol. I think down the line, if I'm starting to feel like I'm unhappy with how my skin is aging based on what I'm doing right now, which is more of a skin fortifying or building integrity approach. If you want to hear about this, I did a whole podcast episode on my skincare philosophy. It's episode 6 and it's called My Current Skincare Philosophy, discussing skin integrity, retinol, facial massage, and more. And if you don't have a favorite podcast player, you can listen to them on my website. I'll link the exact blog post with that episode below. This is such an individual thing, and I just really want to stress that there are no right or wrong answers. I think sometimes people can feel like a little bit insecure or offended if what you're saying somehow threatens what they've been doing. So a good example of this is there's a holistic esthetician I follow, Haley Wood, the therapeutic skin coach. I talk about her a lot. She had done these posts about how everyone asks her about retinol, like all the time. Everyone wants her opinion on retinol and she doesn't use them and she doesn't ever talk about them. She actually doesn't disclose why, but she just doesn't use them and she never talks about them. And she's like, why does everyone ask me about this and I never talk about it? They obviously just want to hear her professional opinion on it. The only way to navigate skincare, and skincare for me is like a microcosm of these bigger issues about how we navigate like any health related information that comes our way. You just have to see how like it resonates, like with your mind, with your heart, with your being. If you are like, yeah, retinol, full steam ahead, wonderful. If that's how you feel, then it's probably having some sort of different cell metabolism effect than someone that has trepidation approaching it. Do you know what I mean? It's very what the bleep do we know, but everyone is going to metabolize and synthesize things differently. So this is just the perspective that I've been in. Like, there literally are no right answers to this, but the bigger questions that I have are more about how the infusion of bakuchiol into eco beauty as replicating broader mainstream skincare agendas, I find potentially troubling, but really just a discussion point. I think we can all agree that mainstream skincare, like the mainstream dermatological industry, I mean, people like Carolyn Hirons, Dr. Dre, pretty much every single person in the skincare industry is going to recommend using a retinol as part of a healthy aging routine. Now, what we've seen happening in eco beauty is that ideology has really seeped in the last couple of years because it really didn't used to be this way. I think Marie Veronique was one of the first brands that had a gentle retinol product, but she was alone in that for a very long time. Now I think with this discovery of bakuchiol, it's like kind of getting thrown in everything, you know, ostensibly because the results are so good. And I brought this up on Instagram stories, which is that how we define results in skincare is really quite narrowly defined right now. And I think most people are gonna say, yeah, I use skincare because I want my skin to look a certain way. And actually the reason why I appreciate people like Haley Wood is that they have broader framework, and Brita Beauty or people in the Gua Sha space, they have a broader framework for what it means to have a relationship with your skin, that it's not just about topicals, that it's not just about the visible effects of your skin, that beauty as a realm, beauty products, skincare specifically, skincare modalities, are a potential way to connect with self and have effectively what could be a spiritual practice or a meditation practice or mindfulness practice. So I think that that's the only thing I really want to raise, is that the bakuchiol phyto-retinol explosion in eco beauty, I think it's wonderful for people that for whatever reason can't tolerate retinols, that really want this kind of product, that have a green light go from their consciousness about these kind of products. Wonderful. But then there's people like, you know, this woman that wrote to me, and how I feel too, where like I don't necessarily feel right now that I need that kind of product. And that's really just something that only you can ascertain for yourself. And I think contemplating what a skincare philosophy looks like for you is just an interesting thought exercise. everything changes. Nothing exists in a vacuum, and context is everything. I could change my mind next year because, I mean, the effects of postpartum, like having a baby, are so depleting on the system. And I actually do hear a lot of women talk about how they just feel like having kids really wipes out their system and their reserves. So in that sense, I love that these products exist. And at the same time, I'm able to kind of try and hold that other perspective where I'm like, well, but why is Green Beauty just trying to replicate another version of a mainstream skincare agenda? So it's all of these things. It's a deep discussion that starts tapping into these other facets of like what beauty means to us. And that's honestly why I've always loved beauty products. It's not really just the products for me personally. It's an invitation to explore like all of these other issues. And that's really what I try and do through LAMOUR. Like, I love talking about like products and textures and the sensory experience of products, but I also love all of these other aspects about what beauty is really meaning to us and how that evolves with us over time. So that was an extremely long ramble. I've gone on way longer than I wanted. I hope that it made some sense and maybe just instilled a different perspective or way of thinking about these things. So I would love to hear what you think of this box, your perspective on retinol, your perspective on skin aging and skin health. I'm really glad that I had the opportunity to address these things, and I think this box was such a nice opportunity to do so. I'll see you soon with some more like interactive videos. I have a bunch of like sit down and talk videos to do, but I think before that I want to do get ready with me on here. I do them all the time on Patreon, but I realize I neglect them on here because I'm doing them all the time on Patreon. I want to do a get ready with me on here. I want to take you into the bathroom and do a skincare routine, that kind of stuff. And then maybe we'll reconvene here and I'll do like a disappointing products or some empties on here. Make sure you go check out Your Purpose is Beauty. I'm over there every Monday. So Sundays on YouTube, Mondays on the podcast, Patreon and Instagram pretty much all the time. Thank you guys for supporting LAMOUR. It means everything to me. I don't think I have time to close out with like any extraneous Beauty Heroes announcements or LAMOUR info. So let's just leave it at that, and I'll see you guys soon. Bye.